The following video is sponsored by waifubait.moe, an online realtor for anime-themed stickers. Currently, their selection is made up of a growing list of best girls, from Megumin to Zero Two to Toga, and even fan artist's latest obsession, Rika. Speaking of which, they partner with original creators to bring you these stickers, with a new one every 2 weeks. So if your waifu isn't featured yet, check back later. Their product is also covered in a high-quality, weather-resistant vinyl finish to protect them. And best of all, shipping in the US is free, and you can get $1 off your first sticker with code TASERLAD. Links to their site will be in the description and comments. Now let's start the video. Woo! 2018 is gone already. Feels like we hardly knew ye. But as the sun sets on the year, so too does it set on 4 seasons of anime and a whopping 188 projects produced. Good God, that is a lot to sift through. So much that, yeah, I can in no way encapsulate the year in a succinct little video because I can't justify giving every series a chance. At least, not yet. But I did kind of drop the ball last year with my wrap-up video. Okay, maybe not so much drop the ball as hit it and pretended it never existed. I was a little too ambitious because by the time I was halfway done recording it, we were approaching February. No longer incredibly topical. So this year is gonna be a little different. Because I'll be honest, I really don't like lists. I routinely struggle to pick favorites or rank things in general. So this time around, no top 5s or top 10s, I'm just gonna talk about 2018. Shows, characters, and moments that stood out to me these past 12 months. If I fail to mention a series in this video, that doesn't mean I automatically hated it, and likewise, inclusion doesn't mean I outright loved it. So having said that, feel free to let me know what you thought about any series, included or excluded, as well as the year in general, in the comments down below. Let's do this. In retrospect, winter was a strong start to the year, but I don't know if I'd call it the best season necessarily. A Place Further Than the Universe, Yuru Camp, Violet Evergarden, and the first half of Darling in the Franxx were all standouts. Meanwhile, the ambitious project that was Pop Team Epic gave no f**ks and took no prisoners. And really, I think the biggest compliment I can give the winter season is staying power. All the series I mentioned continue to be talked about, with those initial three being on the shortlist for many people's anime of the year. A pretty impressive feat considering what the rest of 2018 gave us. As for my thoughts on the series? Well, I've already rewatched it since it aired, and I still love A Place Further Than the Universe. For the many reasons I, as well as many, many people in the anime community have stated. Yuru Camp was also thoroughly enjoyable and the perfect complement to the cold winters I am personally accustomed to. And this is just a theory of mine, but I honestly think these two airing in the same season helped the other. One was all about the ambition of youth and going off on this grand adventure. Meanwhile, the other focused on the beauty in this world you can find in your own backyard and took things at a much slower pace. Each was one half of a bigger whole, united by the common theme of friendship. Maybe I'm reaching a bit, but having Yorimoi as a much-needed inspiration every Tuesday and then to be eased into a hopefully relaxing weekend by Yuru Camp's rustic comfiness helped me appreciate the unique merits of each series, both just catering to a different part of me. Moving on to Darling in the Franxx, well, I don't know if I have anything terribly unique to say as I feel just about every base has been covered at this point. It was a decent show that, by its end, became a hell of a ride that any theme park would kill to have. I ultimately don't regret the time I spent with it, and I'm curious to see how I'll view the series through the lens of a rewatch. Pop Team Epic, meanwhile, did Pop Team Epic things, and it was a fun time. Not all the gags landed, but not all of them had to, such is the nature with this kind of show. Really, what was most significant was the sheer creativity on display with some of them. From the different art styles, to the complete changes in medium like with Hellshank Yano, Pop Team Epic was different in a way that only this kind of series could be, and I'm glad it took full advantage of that. As for everything else this season, I have either yet to start it, like with After the Rain, or dropped like with Citrus, Guild Teaser Takagi-san, and that one show where they do nothing but eat ramen. To each their own, and with those latter two, I might consider picking them up again at some point in the future. In terms of favorite characters for this winter season, Hinata was far and away my favorite character of the year, just saying that right now. Specifics as to why for Hinata, I will elaborate in another video that I actually already have written, just haven't gotten around to making yet. Suffice to say, I didn't really relate to any other characters in this first quarter, or year for that matter, the same way I did to her. although honorable mentions of course go out to the rest of the cast of Yorimoi, as well as Yuru Camp's adorable quintet, with probably Chisaki and Rin topping my best girls list for that show specifically. Also, I nearly forgot about Netflix, but they did bring us Devilman Crybaby in January, another show that was thoroughly enjoyed and praised by the community at large, but also one that I haven't heard as consistent a buzz around. Maybe that's on me, but it is worth mentioning as it was also a standout that was dropped on us all at once, without people needing to wait 6 months for a legal streaming option. This was also the case for another popular series Netflix released in the spring of this year, Agretzko, the anime that made everyone laugh and cry together as it gave the middle finger to Japanese work culture and adulting. It's probably a coincidence that two of their most popular shows were made available to everyone all at once, but it is interesting when most of their other shows they held behind metaphorical bars didn't reach near the same level of notoriety. Though you could bring up Be the Beginning and Aiko, among others, as a fair counterpoint to that universal release model meaning guaranteed success. But that's as good a transition as we'll get into spring. If there was a way I would describe this season, it'd be strong starts but weak endings. Which is coincidentally how I would also describe most of my relationships. We had Sword Art Online Alternative, Megalobox, Hinamatsuri, Hisone to Masutan, and Umamusume, all with strong hooks in the form of premise, characters, or animation, with some boasting all three. But out of the ones listed, I personally only enjoyed the endings of two, SAO Alternative and Umamusume. Not that the other endings were bad per se, they just didn't do it for me. Hinamatsuri's final episode was fine, but it was very segmented, switching halfway through to give us some potential season 2 bait that is yet to be announced, when I think it could have been stronger with the focus put squarely on Nita and Hina. Though its whole nature as a primarily comedic series meant this format wasn't jarring. Just par for the course when I wanted something a little more with how good it had been. Megalobox, meanwhile, I kinda saw it coming, but that final fight, without spoilers, just lacked a real X factor and simultaneously took away one of the interesting tidbits that made the universe feel unique. I think I may have misplaced my expectations with this one. Like with Darling in the Franxx, a rewatch could change this opinion, but for now, it left me unsatisfied. And Hisone to Masutan, just gonna say it, I felt like the ending was a mess. Everything about it just seemed rushed. Characters who, based on their established arcs, I expected to make certain decisions, instead pull the 180 for no discernible reason. And it really sucks because I liked a lot of this cast. Hisone was quirky and adorable, Nao was consistently fantastic, and I'm honestly upset I can't enjoy this ending more. But it is what it is. With SAO Alternative and Umamusume, it's not like their finales were perfect, but at least they had satisfying conclusions that were both fun and just felt like good overall send-offs to what their shows were all about. Neither one biting off more than they could chew. Oh, and I also watched Wotokoi. Didn't really fit with that prior theme, I kinda just thought it was pretty good from start to finish. A series that felt almost like a spiritual sequel to Recovery of an MMO Junkie, just with slightly more work culture and much fewer dickish copyright strikes for no good reason. Definitely worth a watch if Morioka and Sakurai left you wanting more couples cuteness. I would also generally classify spring of 2018 as the season of most underrated shows. Between the likes of Comic Girls, Lupin the Third, and Golden Kamuy, there just wasn't a ton of discourse within the community. Obviously, certain pockets appreciated each of them, like Annie Twitter consistently praising Comic Girls specifically for its portrayal of self-doubt and general anxiety when it comes to the creative process and its respective bells and whistles, but broadly speaking, all of these shows deserve more exposure. For the reasons I just mentioned with Comic Girls, the excellent social commentary in Lupin the Third despite the series being nearly 50 years old, and Golden Kamuy for being an eccentric adventure with an even more outlandish cast of characters, all while still having genuinely stirring emotional moments. With this one especially, I think people unfairly wrote it off early on because of the egregious use of CGI, but I'd recommend giving it a second chance if that is indeed what turned you off about it. I promise you, you're in for a grand, weird time. As for characters, I thoroughly enjoyed the main cast of both Hinamatsuri and Comic Girls, to the point where I really can't single out a favorite. Though if you forced me to pick, my gut reaction would probably say Hitomi and Ruki respectively. I likewise loved most of the horse girls in Umamusume, with it probably coming down to a photo finish between El Condor Pasa and Special Week. Finally, Len and Fuka had great chemistry whenever they were on screen together in or out of GGO, and their antics in the second squad jam were some of the most fun I had during the spring season. It's possible I was still being influenced by that OMG friendship high that Yorimoe had left me, but considering this one was bathed in bloodshed, I'll chalk it more up to the things this alternative version of Sword Art Online did right. On to summer. With this season, I remember having, I think, the lowest expectations going in. Sure, Attack on Titan Season 3 was airing, Hiroaka was rolling into its second core after a strong first half, but I didn't have many new shows at first glance that I was planning on watching. I gave Island a chance, purely because it was one of the first shows to premiere, and we saw how that turned out. Yeah, looking back, Cells at Work was really the only show I had down as a definite from the beginning. And I've already given my thoughts on the series, but if you haven't watched it and at all enjoyed high school or college biology, then this show will most likely have you grinning from ear to ear at some point. That being said, it also proved to be a summer of surprises, with Planet With, Asobi Asobase, and Revue Starlight all proving to be entertaining in their own right. Though I don't think I loved Planet With or Revue Starlight quite as much as some of the others in the community. Both definitely deserve a rewatch before that opinion is cemented, but at the same time, I don't have an incredible desire to do so in the near future. So I guess we'll see. Lupin the Third I thought had a great ending to its Part 5, and Harukana Receive was an enjoyable sports series that was perfect for summer. I've heard Grand Blue is likewise entertaining, but it got old for me pretty quickly. I just couldn't quite relate to the drunken college shenanigans when I can count on one hand the number of times I was tipsy during those years, let alone drunk. If anything, I think it'll be one of those series I end up reading the manga of in place of the anime. My favorite characters of summer, mainly, as you might expect, boil down to Cells at Work. Kana Hanazawa was the perfect casting choice for our adorkable urethrocyte protagonist. Just a joy to watch whenever she was on screen. White Blood Cell was also hilarious as he went about killing every invading pathogen in warm blood. I also very much enjoyed the interactions of the central trio in Planet With, and the relationship that developed between them as the series went on. It felt very natural and sweet at the same time. And I enjoyed the trio in Asobi Asobase for the exact opposite reasons. But now we reach the season that's most prevalent in everyone's memories, thanks to it being the most recent. Fall. Even despite this advantage though, I dare say it was the best 2018 had to offer. Like I said, I'm not making an official list or ranking, but just in terms of the sheer number of shows I enjoyed week to week, I think Fall wins. From that time I got reincarnated as a slime, Rascal Does Not Dream of Bunny Girl Senpai, Skullface Bookseller Honda-san, to holy shit, shorter names please, like Gridman, Run With the Wind, Bloom Into You, the second half of Golden Kamuy, and Zombieland Saga. So much quality was packed into these last 3 months, and I'm still leaving out shows that people loved but I just haven't had the time to get to, like Boarding School Juliet and Release the Spice. Overall, it just feels like Fall knocked it out of the park. A great end to a pretty darn good year of anime, in my opinion. And that might honestly be this season's biggest hindrance. I, as well as several other AnnieTubers, have already talked to death about the shows we adored this season, to the point where the stuff that's still good in its own right is getting swept under the rug, when, if they had aired in a weaker season, might have been near the top. So, if you haven't heard much about any of the shows I just mentioned, give them a shot, and you might find something you really like. This season was also overflowing with great characters. The entire cast of both Bunny Girl Senpai and Zombieland Saga made the race for Best Girl incredibly heated, and that's without even mentioning Gridman's Akane and Rika. Two characters boasting incredibly appealing aesthetics. What? But no, in all honesty, I love so many of these girls, with Saki being my best girl from Zombieland Saga, and either Mai, Koga, or Kaede claiming that crown in Bunny Girl Senpai, depending on the day of the week. Rika vs. Akane is likewise a coin flip. But I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Yu, my hands down favorite character from the season and second only to Hinata on the year. She's just so good, adorable, and deserves everything. And the thing is, despite what I just said, I know that's only a fraction of the reasons why I've enjoyed watching her progression, but I can't place the rest. It's this intangible sensation of sympathy and just wanting to see her be happy. It's a feeling I personally don't often develop for fictional characters. Anyway, that wraps it up for the girls, but this season was also not without a shortage of great boys, with the entire male-centric casts of Run With The Wind and Golden Kamuy being a continuous delight. Tatsumi, as the necromanager for Franchushu, likewise brought a smile to my face with a shtick that I'm surprised never got old. And rounding this all out is a character who kind of fits into neither the best girl or boy category, our slime friend Rimuru. A delightful isekai protagonist who has been so much fun to watch as they work their way towards unintended world domination. And with the light of 2018 fading, I'm incredibly happy to have them carry the torch into the new year. The same goes for Haiji and the rest of the Kansai University Track Club. With both these series carrying over, it's certainly looking like 2019 will start off on the right foot. Even with all that though, I can't help but feel there are things left unsaid about this past year. Shows not mentioned, or maybe just not mentioned enough, despite no doubt deserving it in some people's minds. But I feel that's almost guaranteed with this kind of wrap-up video. I might have enjoyed a lot of series that you dropped within the first 5 minutes. Just as well, the reverse might also be true. And so with that in mind, I encourage you to share your favorite shows, characters, and moments from 2018 in the comments down below. And also let me know what series you're most looking forward to in 2019. Any and all additional comments are also welcome. Thank you so much for watching, and a special thanks goes out to the sponsor of this video, waifubait.moe. Again, go ahead and check them out, information is in the description and comments. But the biggest thanks, as always, goes out to my awesome patrons, PenguinPandaZero, Overjoyed Soup, MVPino, James Morton, Marbled Ranger, Spudge, Bjorn, and everybody else who helps make videos like these possible. Links to that Patreon, my shirts, and everything else are either down below or on the screen right now. Leave a like and click that bell icon. Thanks for an awesome 2018, everyone, and I hope 2019 is even better. I'll see you next time.